So great to be back with you all. And to add to the CV, I also was officially, I'm officially an IGS alum because I was on Jacques' payroll for a few years as a part-time employee when you all moved up here to Baltimore. So great to be here. I'm going to tell you about one of our main focuses over the past 4 years since I've been at NIH, and that's nanopore sequencing. I had a great time chatting with Pavel this morning about some of the microbial genomic stuff we're still doing. Not a whole lot of that in this talk. Hopefully I can catch you later on if you want to hear what we've been doing in that space. This, because I'm now at the Human Genome Institute, is a talk very heavily focused on the human genome. I also want to start with a little bit of history. This isn't going to take 40 years to go through, but 40 years of genome assembly, and I was becoming a little nostalgic because NHGRI had their silver anniversary this year, and we were looking back retrospectively at what had happened, and that had me thinking, you know, I've been working on this genome assembly problem for my whole career, basically, ever since I was at Tiger. How long has this been going on? And if we go back, 1980 really is the origination. Actually, 1979 is the origination of this problem. And if you go through Google Scholar, you can find this great paper from Roger Staden, who was at Cambridge, I think, at the time. 1979 has been digitized and is online now. And he developed the first computer program for genome assembly. And this was to combine gel readings together into larger sequences. And there's this great quote, which I put up for you here, where he describes the genome assembly process as succinctly as you will ever see it described, talking about if you have the 5' end of your sequence gel overlapping the 3' end of your other sequence gel, and they overlap long enough that you can distinguish that from being a repeat, you can stick them together and get a contiguous sequence. And this is the essence of the genome assembly problem. And I've highlighted the key phrase here, that you want that overlap to be long enough to distinguish it from being a repeat, because the repeats in the genome are the only thing that really make genome assembly difficult. And if your reads are long enough that nothing is a repeat anymore, because your reads are long, assembly becomes very easy. And this is also the origin of all of the jargon that we take for granted now, of gel readings being your reads, the overlaps being the overlaps, and the contiguous sequences that you're joining together being the contigs. So it really does date back 40 years. We've been working on that problem ever since and haven't really solved it. To put you in the space of 1980, what was happening at the time, this is how you would be doing your home computing on your VIC-20. I had one of these programming games on it back in the day. Smith-Waterman was published in 81, BLAST was published in 81, and the first genome sequence of Lambda, 82, obviously, Fred Sanger and company. I show the VIC-20 there because all of these genome assembly improvements and sequencing improvements in general have gone hand in hand with improvements in compute technology along the way. So there was this period from 1980 to 1993, which I leave blank on my timeline. I'm sure there was a lot of great work done here, but I was in elementary school, so I don't remember it. Notable events, 1995. This is around the time when I started being introduced to the field of genomics. Having worked with Art Delcher at Loyola in 1998, who was working at Tiger at the time, part-time. Tiger Assembler from Granger Sutton, Owen White and others were working on this. 1995, obviously, Haemophilus influenza, first complete bacterial genome sequence done. And Gene Myers was working on formulation of the genome assembly problem theoretically in 1995, introducing this concept of sequence overlapping graphs. And this is when the computer scientists started to get heavily involved in the problem and formulate. Each of these little dots is my sequencing read. The overlaps are the connections between them. That forms this graph, which computer scientists are very comfortable in analyzing, and we can use those to improve our genome assemblies. A lot happened between 1995 and 2000. Obviously, this is around the turn of the announcement of the first human draft, both the private and public efforts coming out in 2001. A year prior to that, from Celera, the first whole genome assembly of Drosophila. So there was this huge rapid pace. Anybody who was at Tiger back in the time remembers how rapidly everything was progressing from, say, 95 to the early 2000s. And it was an invigorating time, and really I credit the start of my career for being embedded in that environment early on and getting me interested in all of these things. Then we have this other blank period from 2001 to 2012, which I illustrate with the wood chipper, because we were taking all of our beautiful high molecular weight DNA and shredding it into Illumina reads and then trying to figure out how we're going to assemble the genome from these tiny pieces. And you think back to that Staden quote, if we really care about the length of these overlaps, if we take all of the genome and shred it into 100 base pair fragments, it makes the assembly problem very difficult. So not to say there wasn't good work done, the introduction of de Brown graphs, Pavel Pevsner and others, really great theoretical work that made use of this data, and it was so cheap that we kind of had to use it. A lot of draft genomes done, a lot of resequencing studies done, it was hugely influential, but not great for assembly. So this was kind of an assembly dark ages for people like me that really care about long reads. Around 2010, the first PacBio instruments became available, and this is when I joined NBAC in 2010. And one of the reasons that I joined them, they're a bioforensics outfit in Frederick, run by Homeland Security and the FBI, doing microbial forensics. One of the reasons they were able to recruit me was because they had the first commercial PacBio instrument. And when that instrument came out and was offering 5 kb reads, this seemed like, you know, a transformational moment after I was sick of having to deal with 50 base pair early Illumina reads. And I really kind of saw the potential of those long reads and said, I want to analyze this data. So the question is, how long do the reads need to be before the assembly problem becomes easy? We had this figure back in 2013. It's one of my favorite figures that I've generated, showing the repeat landscape of all of the microbial genomes at the time. So using my Nukemer tool, we took all of the closed bacterial genomes in RefSeq, we aligned them against one another, and we discovered all of the repeats that were in all of the genomes in RefSeq at the time, 2013. And then I plot these two histograms. On the x-axis is showing the repeat count, the copy number in one genome, and the y-axis is the repeat size. And if I recall, these are genomes, these are repeats that are above, say, 95% identical to one another, maybe 98%. And then this density diagram is showing you where all of the most common repeats are. And this spot right here is telling you that the vast majority of bacterial repeats are less than 7,000 bases long, and they're less than 100 copies. There's a bunch of outliers, like Yersinia pestis has a bunch of insertion sequences that are short, but there's a lot of them. And there's things like, you know, E. coli that like to just ingest all kinds of nasty phage and so on that induce big repeats in their genomes. But the vast majority of them are less than 7 kb. And so this is really the golden threshold for assembly, because that's the size of the RDNA repeat in bacterial genomes. And that tends to be the largest repeat in most of them. If you can get reads that are longer than the RDNA repeat, you can close bacterial genomes. And that's why now you put something on the PacBio, give it to the informatics team, they can give you a complete genome back again, because the reads are longer than 7 kb. And for somebody that worked on genome assembly for the 10 years prior to that, and saw the Tiger finishing teams, you know, dumping millions of dollars and doing PCR experiments to get all of these last few gaps nailed down, to throw it into the PacBio and get a single contig out per chromosome was just awesome. So that really got us excited. So we started developing software to do this, and we adapted the old Celera assembler software to deal with the new PacBio data, and we showed the first bacterial genomes could be completed using that figure as part of our evidence in 2012. And we started looking for more and more difficult problems. We could complete the bacterial genomes now. We wanted to complete larger things. We did yeast in 2014 using similar methods. Drosophila also in 2014, also using PacBio. And I'm showing the genome sizes here from 1 million, 10 million, 100 million base pairs per genome. And it just seemed like an extrapolation to me. If every 2 years we're going up one order of magnitude in genome scale, the human genome should be done any day now. This was around the time, 2014, when I was at NBAC, and I said they're a microbial forensics outfit. I started looking for more and more difficult assembly projects. We started doing the goat genome, and maybe they're wondering why you're doing the goat genome if you're at a microbial forensics institute. So I thought maybe I should find greener pastures. So we moved to NHGRI so that we could work on things like the human genome. Which now obviously 3 gigabase pair genome. What many people don't realize, if you're not a nerd about these things, is that the human genome was never really finished. They announced the first draft in 2001, but it was not a very complete draft based on the standards that we use today. And even to this day, it's not finished. So this device called the Oxford Nanopore MinION first came out in 2014, and this was promising even longer reads than the PacBio. I had this idea in my head that we wanted to do the human genome. I joined NHGRI, and my application packet for that job had as one of the specific aims, very humble aim, to finish the human genome using my small 6-person group at NHGRI. And we've been working on that since we've been there, and exciting results to show. So the human genome's not finished. There's about 100 gaps currently left, and there's even more regions that I would say are questionable. They're closed, but they're probably not correct. There's a lot of segmental duplications, large multi-hundred KB repeats across the human genome that make assembly difficult. There's the RDNA arrays, just like in bacteria, they cause difficulty in human assembly. And then there's the heterochromatin, the centromeres, the telomeres, and so forth, that make assembly in human difficult. I was talking to Manu earlier, and he said, okay, sure, but who cares about these things? They do contain important information in some places. I agree, in a lot of them, heterochromatin, maybe not that interesting. But there are places in the RDNA where we're finding novel variation and potentially novel genes embedded within the RDNA repeats. The segmental duplications have a large literature in their association with disease. Basically, you're copying a 100 KB chunk of the human genome. All of the genes that are in there are going with that additional chunk. Now you have two copies. You have extra paralogs. They can functionally specialize in different ways. And so basically, we don't know what we don't know. We've never seen this sequence before at a high level of fidelity. We know it's associated with a lot of diseases. You look at things like HLA genes and so forth, huge associations with disease, complex region of the genome that's not well studied. Nailing that down will help reveal these associations and point to their functional mechanisms. To solve the problem doesn't take a genius. We go back to Stad in 1979 telling us that long reads basically are the solution to the assembly problem. So we're looking for platforms that give us long reads. All of that early work that I talked about was PacBio that enabled great assemblies of bacteria, Drosophila, human, the likes of which we hadn't seen before. But it wasn't closing the human genome yet. There were still large repeats in there that weren't closed. So we started looking at the Nanopore. We were developing tools, the Canoe Assembler, which Manu mentioned in my introduction. That's our latest long-read sequencing assembler designed for both PacBio and Nanopore data. And in 2018, just last year, with a consortium including Matt Luce and Nick Lohman in the UK, developed a protocol that they're calling ultra-long reads, which is taking read lengths now up to a scale of megabases per read. So we think about the progression. We've got the Sanger day. We have a 1,000 base read. We went backwards to 100 base Illumina reads. We went up to 10 KB PacBio reads. Now we're going up to 100 KB, 1 million base pair Nanopore reads. And the way that this works is just complete black magic to me, that ONT, Oxford Nanopore, has figured out a way to take an actual transporter protein from E. coli. So this is a membrane pore, CSGG membrane protein from E. coli, engineered it a little bit for their purposes, figured out a way to have it insert itself into lipid membranes and process single strands of DNA down through that little protein nanopore. And there's a little constriction site here in the middle of the pore such that there's a very narrow channel that that single strand of DNA can feed through. There's ionic current flowing through that pore in real time, and you're measuring changes in that current over time as that DNA strand gets passed through the pore. You apply even more black magic called machine learning to that signal to then deconvolute that current over time trace into ACGs and Ts, and it works. Right? This is just completely mind-boggling, and the scale of it is also crazy. I said we can get megabase pair reads. If the nanopore was scaled up to the size of my fist and I was threading, you know, a string of DNA through there, a megabase read is like threading 2 miles of rope through your fist at 3 miles an hour. So you can sequence a megabase read like that in less than an hour's time. So we started looking for things to apply these to. This is our collaborator, Matt Luce, sequencing DNA in his hotel room at AGBT a few years ago to demonstrate the portability of this. These MinIONs are basically handheld devices you plug into a laptop, do your library prep, which in this case involved the coffee maker in some way, and sequence it. You get this data coming off those nanopores in real time. Clive Brown, the chief scientific officer of ONT, sequenced his own genome. So his claim to fame now is the first person to do their own genome sequencing, including the library preparation, loading the flow cells, and getting DNA out the other side. And in this case, 60x coverage of his genome using these nanopore devices. So I want to show you kind of what that looks like compared to where we were in 2001. This is the announcement of the human genome in 2001. Billions of dollars, you know, rooms of sequencers, great fanfare. This is showing the continuity, okay? So this isn't like a typical band that you would see. These are contigs. So each of these horizontal bands is a contig of that assembly in 2001. So anytime there's a change between black to gray, that's a gap. All right. So the bigger these pieces, the bigger the contigs. So this large black section here is a large contiguous piece of sequence in the human genome. This chromosome 1, where it's all heavily banded, is tiny little contigs. The average size of these contigs are only 500 kb when this was released in 2001. I said just on the last slide we can get megabase reads now. We can get single reads that are longer than the size of the contigs back in 2001. And this was done, you know, using back-by-back, you know, cloning techniques, hugely time intensive and labor intensive. Same diagram for Clive's genome last year, and this is the continuity. So average contig size here is 30 megabase pairs per contig, per gap. And you can start to see now some of these chromosome arms, like the short arm of 20 here, short arm of 9, are in single pieces from telomere to centromere without any gaps. Right? So it's amazing progress in 16 years' time. That's all well and grand, but the continuity is not the end of the story. You need to not just have these contigs assembled, but you also want all of the bases to be correct. This is where we're still playing a bit of catch up with nanopore technology. Each of the individual reads is about 10% error, 90% accuracy. When you pile them up to get consensus, the best we can do right now is about 99.76, 99.8% identity. That's QV20 something. Compared to QV40, 99.99% identity that we expect of our reference genomes, that's not quite meeting the standard. There's ways we can deal with that, combining Illumina technology, even combining PacBio technology, to get that up to par. The issue is that when you're threading individual nucleotides through this pore, you're not looking at dyes like we've done for Sanger sequencing, 454 sequencing, even PacBio sequencing. You just have a single signal trace. So say there's a bunch of DNA inside of that pore and you're reading off a current and you need to figure out what bases were in there. Some of these bases look a lot like the other bases, right? You have your purines. I'm not a biochemist, but I can tell you those two diagrams look more similar than these two diagrams. And as a consequence, some of those bases have similar characteristics when they're in the pore when it comes to how much ionic current they're allowing to flow through different resistances. So this can sometimes get mixed up based on how you're doing the base calling. This differs by chemistry. The base callers, the chemistries are frequently iterating and improving. This makes it a bit of a pain to deal with because you always have to adapt your pipelines to deal with the latest and greatest. But it's, you know, it's candy if you're a bioinformatician because it's always new data to play with. So we really love playing with this stuff. The sequencing cores, you know, maybe not so much, but they're coming around. One question I'm always asked is, well, if the sequencing error rate isn't great, why don't you just use Illumina data to polish this at the end and have perfect genomes? The insight here is that you can't polish the repeats with Illumina data because you can't figure out where they map in the genome, right? So if we're using the long reads because we want to assemble the repeats, the long reads are the reason we can now assemble the repeats. The Illumina data is not going to come and magically figure out which repeat it is assigned to because it's too short. So therefore, your repeats are always going to be junk when you're looking at Illumina assembly. The paralogs are always going to be kind of a mosaic of themselves. Same goes for even diploid genomes and so forth. So the long reads, even though they have a higher kind of native error rate, they give you much better reconstructions of the repetitive genomes, like HLA genes, like these rDNA repeats, and so on. So if you want to get a good assembly, you got to polish that assembly with the long reads. PacBio has been really good with their chemistries because they have roughly a random error process, which means if I look at the same position in the genome 50 times with 50 different reads, that's really 50 independent experiments, and I can statistically remove that error when I call consensus. If you do it with nanopore as to date, there's still some bias in there that prohibits us from removing all of that error and puts a ceiling on the consensus that we can get. But nonetheless, if these red marks here are my errors in my final assembly, and I want to analyze these to polish them out. Say this is like a four-copy paralog in my genome, and I want to understand each of those four copies. Out of the assembler, those four copies typically will look exactly like one another. The assembler will tend to make a mosaic representation of those copies and give you a consensus view of the repeat rather than the individual copies. So we want to polish it to figure out what's going on. We map our Illumina data. It only maps to the unique regions of the genome, so therefore it only polishes the bits that were not repetitive, and we're still left with errors in our repeats. If we then can map the long reads across these repeats, now notice that there's reads spanning those repeats, so they're anchored on either side with unique sequence, we can confidently place them onto the assembly and then look at the signal data that we got from the sequencer to get the best possible consensus that we can get. We reveal that those four repeat copies were not identical. They all are unique. And if these are HLA genes, you can think now, okay, this even has immunological consequences to the genome. It's important stuff to get right. In some cases where we've attempted to use short reads to polish long reads assemblies, we've actually found it to make the assembly worse because the short reads are mismapping and then they introduce additional errors into the assembly that weren't even there in the first place. So even though the long reads get a bad rap sometimes for being noisy, they're essential to getting these types of the regions correct, these regions of the genome correct. So can we really finish the human genome using this technology? We've been working on this, and I'm as optimistic as I've ever been that this is going to be possible, probably within the next 1 to 2 years, because I hope I've demonstrated to you that it really is just a matter of the read length, the throughput, the read accuracy, and all three of those categories have been making huge strides over the past 5 years with Nanopore and PacBio. Currently, we're focusing on the X chromosome just because we wanted to pick a region of the genome to target, and I'll be happy to announce next month at AGBT that we've finally finished the X. And so we have the first end-to-end gapless assembly of a human chromosome and the X, which is a pretty significant chromosome nonetheless. So I'll be talking about that at AGBT if you're going the end of February. The remaining challenges, Nanopore consensus quality, as I mentioned, targeted long read sequencing. A lot of times we spend a lot of time sequencing regions of the genome that are easy. It'd be great if we could focus the reads only on the parts of the genome that we know up front are going to be difficult. Library prep techniques, sequencing techniques might be able to handle this. Better informatic methods for noisy long reads. And then lastly, I've kind of glossed over some of the details here talking about genomes as if there's only one, but most humans are diploid. You've got polyploids in plants, you've got metagenomes. These are where the assembly challenges are now in the field. We've really kind of solved isolate bacterial assembly. That's not really an interesting problem anymore. Human, I think, will be solved with long reads. Doing this correctly now is the next frontier for this research. So I'll talk about that now, the genomes assembly problem. We've been mispronouncing it. There's actually an S on there, because when we're doing humans, there's two genomes to reconstruct. We don't have just one pile of pieces that we're trying to put together one box. Really, there's kind of two boxes, two different puzzles that got all thrown onto the table at the same time, and we want to assemble them separately, right? To illustrate that, I'll use this cattle hybrid Esperanza. So this is from Tim Smith, my longtime collaborator at USDA, who cares a lot about getting haplotypes correct because he works with a lot of cattle ranchers that want to know where are the disease variants in my genome, where are the variants that have quantitative trait associations with better cows. And so we looked at Esperanza for one particular reason, that she's actually a hybrid. She's a hybrid between a yak and a Highlander bull, which is a type of cow. And like any diploid, she's got two pairs of every chromosome, one copy from her mom, one copy from her dad. So that means for chromosome one of her haplotypes is actually a yak haplotype, and the other haplotype is a Highlander haplotype. So if we want to assemble Esperanza's genome, we don't want to assemble one puzzle, we actually want to assemble two puzzles. So by sequencing Esperanza, correctly assembling her genome, we're going to get a genome for a yak and a genome for a Highland. I had never met this bull before, but actually, if you saw the movie Ferdinand with your kids, he's in that movie, shaggy hair guy. Scottish, I believe. So if we look at that from an assembly perspective, what have we been doing wrong? If you look at Esperanza's genome, the assemblers typically, as I said, represent it as a graph. The regions of homozygosity between the two haplotypes get collapsed into a single path. So she has two copies of the sequence, but they're identical, so the assembler just smashes it together. The regions of her haplotypes that are different because they have yak-specific and Highland-specific variants get broken out into these bubbles. So if the assembler looks at it like this, this is what we would kind of want to return to you as a user, but everybody likes fastophiles. And fastophiles are a single linear representation. And so what we've done, dirty secret of the whole assembly community for the last 15 years, is we smash the bubbles together in a not very elegant way and give you what I was calling a consensus or a mosaic representation of those variants. And this is not a good thing to do because the variants in those bubbles, when you smash them together, can introduce things like frame shifts, which will then mess up your annotation downstream. We found as you do more and more outbred animals, this becomes more and more of a problem. And in fact, the majority of the errors that we've found from PacBio genomes in the past 5 years have not come from sequencing error. It's come from this process of smashing haplotypes together, introducing errors because you haven't dealt with the haplotypes correctly up front. There's been some progress on this in the past few years. There's an algorithm called Falcon Unzip that Jason Chin at PacBio developed that uses this concept of a pseudohaplotype. The 10x genomics assembler also uses this concept. And it says, well, rather than smash the haplotypes together, how about I just randomly pick a haplotype for you as I walk through that graph? This is okay. It doesn't give you the perfect haplotypes, as we can see. We have a mosaic of our puzzle now. But at least now every allele in the genome is accurate. So this kind of has removed the frame shift problem. But if we want to get the yak and the Highland genome, it's not solving the problem. What we really want to do is split Esperanza into her two haplotypes and pull those bubbles apart and present it to you. The problem is when we look at Esperanza in here, I've colored them here blue and red based on the haplotype. But the assembler doesn't have that information. It doesn't know the colors. It just knows the reads that it was given. So to figure out which bubble goes with which haplotype is the challenge. So Sergey Korin, a staff scientist, and Arang Ri, a postdoc in my lab, developed this method last year, which I'm really excited about because it's so simple to explain and to implement, and it works so well. And anytime you can get a method that's simple and it works well, best of both worlds. So the observation here is that if we're trying to do these haplotypes, and we know one haplotype came from the mom and one haplotype came from the dad, why don't we just sequence the parents? And this will make the idea easier. Trio sequencing is not new. People have been doing trios in humans and other animals for many years. But how we're using that information is new. So in this case, we did a cattle cross. We have the dad, which cattle people call the sire, and the dam, which is the mom. And each of them have their own set of haplotypes. Here, the sire in this case is an Angus cow, so he's got two sets of Angus haplotypes, which we have in blue. The dam in this case is a Brahmin, and so she has two red haplotypes. We sequence them just using Illumina sequencing, so very cheap and affordable, and we get two sets of camers, where a camer is just a short 20 base pair piece of sequence that we get off of the Illumina instrument. And we do a set intersection and say how many of these sequences are shared between the mom and the dad, and how many are unique only to the mom or unique only to the dad. And here are our colors. The light blue are sequences that are unique to the sire. We've never seen that sequence in the mom. Red means it's unique in the mom. We've never seen that in the dad. Then we sequence their F1, okay? And you think about the F1, it inherited one blue haplotype and it inherited one haplotype. Of course, these have recombined prior to inheritance, but that's not a big deal because we're just looking at camers. And they're very short, so the recombination doesn't really affect this. Now we basically have that coloring. We know how to paint our sequences, whether they came from the mom or the dad, based on the camers that we saw. It's just haplotype-specific markers. Now we spend our money sequencing the F1 using the long reads. So we collect PacBio or Nanopore sequencing for the F1. And for every long read sequence that comes off the sequencer, before we do anything else, we just ask, does this sequence have more camers in it from the mom or more camers in it from the dad? Is it more blue or is it more red? Just looking at camers, which are super easy to count, can be done very efficiently informatic-wise. Then before assembly, we bin those into the sire haplotype and the dam haplotype and assemble them separately. So we basically removed the diploid from the problem, and now we're assembling haploid read sets of the sire and the dam. All of the complexity and the tangles that are introduced into that graph based on the homologous sequence between the two are removed. Haplotype assemblies, these are like bacteria now. We only have one chromosome we need to assemble for each, and we know how to do that well. And so we did this for these cattle crosses and got fantastic results. The caveat here being, the more diverged the parents are, the more markers you'll find. So human tend to be quite inbred compared to these cows. And, you know, say a 0.1% heterozygosity rate. These cattle were, I think, 0.7%, something like that. So you have many more markers to deal with. We have since tried it on human, and it is also possible, just a little bit more difficult. The nice consequence of this now is you get two fastophiles for every chromosome. You get chromosome 1 mom, chromosome 1 dad. You want to find heterozygous structural variation between those chromosomes, you just align those two fastophiles to each other, and all of the variation pops out. SNP variation, structural variation, very precise. And so this is an illustration of our Sire haplotype, our Dam haplotype. We've got regions of divergence, we've got duplications, insertions. We know how to do that and identify that easily. So back to Esperanza. Esperanza means hope in Spanish. I don't know if that was an intentional naming of this calf. Either way, she was the target animal for this and did her with 125x PacBio coverage. So that's about 60x per haplotype now that we have for assembly. Assembled using this trio canoe method, and this is what Esperanza's genome looks like. So we have two genomes, basically, for the price of one. Her Highland haplotype and her Yak haplotype. This is colored like those diagrams I was showing you earlier. All of these ruminants are acrocentric, so the centromeres are at the telomere, not in the middle. And so there's really no centromere you have to span, which makes it easier. Her chromosome 1, largest chromosome in the genome, single contig for Highland haplotype and Yak haplotype. So we're finally at the point where we've got complex vertebrate genomes falling out of the assembler like the microbes were 5-7 years ago. We've got one contig per one chromosome.
Adam, how do you account, it's such incredible coverage, how do you account for these are also really big gaps?
What do you mean really big gaps?
So am I interpreting, when I see 14 and I see gray,
okay,
yeah. 75%.
Yeah, that's me failing to describe this diagram perfectly. The gaps are in white.
Oh, okay.
Black and gray are both contigs. It's just we switch the color so you can see when one contig switches to another. We need a better way to draw these diagrams. So does that make it clear?
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah. So then if you look at 5, that's two contigs for one chromosome. And the gap is the junction between them. So like I said, Esperanza is heterozygous, so she's a little easier to separate. But the plan is now to do this for humans and get two genomes per individual. If you know about things like Busco metrics and contig metrics, the NG50 contig size for this is 70 megabase pairs. That's basically the size of chromosomes. You can't get bigger. And the Buscos are 94% completeness. So Illumina equivalent in terms of quality. And there was no Illumina data added to this assembly. It's just PacBio. Since then, the RefSeq team at NCBI has annotated these haplotypes. And they claim that this assembly has the lowest rate of frameshift of any vertebrate genome they've seen. So to dispel the notion that Illumina is required for high consensus accuracy, this is only PacBio data. It's high coverage, it's haplotype resolved, high quality. So my new kind of soapbox, I admit I was collapsing haplotypes for many years. I've learned my lesson. We're assembling the genomes now, not the genome. For all of the vertebrates we're doing, our preference now is to sequence an outbred heterozygous diploid. The more outbred, the better. And for that, you get two completely phased genomes as a result. So for cattle, they care about all of the breeds of cattle. So you just get a cross and you get two breeds for one sequencing project. It's compatible with existing tools. Graphs are great for computer scientists. They're not great for biologists. Anytime you talk about graph genomes, I see all of the biologists in the room kind of get a little worried. Fastophiles come out of this assembler, one for each haplotype. If you don't have trios, we're looking at ways you can do this with technology like Hi-C or 10x Genomics that will allow the same type of phasing and haplotype classification without the use of these trio markers. That's work in progress. But I really think all of this is leading towards this new paradigm where the haplotypes are the unit of analysis that we deal with rather than the collapsed mosaic genome. Because they're highly accurate, you can get sequenced, resolved structural variation even when it's very complex repeats that are mediating it. You get the sex chromosomes, segmental duplications, all of this works great. So just kind of forward looking, my plan in the next year is to apply this technique to human genomes. So we're doing a human pangenome project. We're gonna start with a pilot of 10 diverse human trios. So these are sourced from the 1,000 genomes samples, and we chose 10 of the most diverse genomes that we could get from that 1,000 genomes project. We're doing it with PacBio, Illumina, Nanopore, 10x, Hi-C, throw everything that we can at these genomes. They're all trios. Separate them with this method, get high quality human haplotypes, 20 as a result. Assemble those, combine them into some type of pangenome representation, and that will allow more accurate genotyping of even retrospective short read data sets. Because now that we know what the structural variation looks like, we can more easily recognize it when we see. Now I know for the old tiger folks, talking about pan genomes for Hervé is old news, but you know, the human people are a little slow to the game. They're just now realizing that pan genomes are a thing, and it's a good idea to talk about this. So I'm getting in on the ground floor, because we've already done this with bacterial genomes. Also for vertebrates, we're doing this not just for humans, but for all vertebrates. So I'm part of this vertebrate genomes project, which is attempting within the next 1 to 2 years to do a single reference genome for all vertebrate orders, so taxonomic orders, of which there's about 260. So we had our first data release in the fall, kind of showing that our assembly pipeline works. This again was Ad Henry in my lab doing this. These 16 genomes are up on Amazon Web Services. You can find them from this link, vgp.github.io. And these are all high quality PAC bioassemblies that have also been scaffolded with Hi-C. So they're chromosome scale, long read, partially phased. We don't have trios for everything. So they're not all completely phased, but they're all partially phased. So are we there yet? I think if we look at the timeline of 40 years of assembly, I think we're really coming to the point where we can claim that we're completing genomes and we've solved the assembly problem. The last remaining challenge are these large repeats, the satellite arrays, the segmental duplications, the RDNAs. Haploid assembly is solved. I showed you the timeline from going from bacterial genomes up to human genomes. Matter of time, I think, for the human reference that we have the reads long enough to complete that in 1 to 2 years. I said we've done it for the X. We're going to start looking at the other chromosomes now. Diploid assembly are solved with this trio method. In cases where we don't have the trio, technology like Hi-C, 10X genomics would be helpful. And so we are entering this new area now. Like we did in microbial genomics, now we're doing in eukaryotic genomics, moving from just single isolates to pangenome talk. So 40 years of technology is a long way to come. All of this work I'm talking about is computer science, algorithmic work to assemble these genomes. Figuring out what these bases are require machine learning and decoding. Obviously, a lot of great biochemistry, biophysics work as well, but all of this goes hand in hand. And so when we look at the gel readings from 1980 and we look at the VIC-20 from 1980, and now we have smartphones, you know, this is the smartphone of sequencing now, and all of those technology improvements have gone hand in hand over the last 40 years. So it's a great time to be working in informatics, great time to be working in genomics. I'm going to pause to give acknowledgments to my group and my collaborators. These are all the great people we've worked with on nanopore sequencing. They don't have a nanopore emoji, so we have donuts instead. Topologically similar, right, Pavel? and my group at NHGRI talking about genome informatics. Couldn't have done it without any of these people. So it's 11:43. Yeah, this goes till noon. I'll save time for questions. I've got three more slides. I want to end on a little bit of an inspirational note, right? So just like these things, we democratized computing, going from supercomputers that took a whole room to run. Think of that as our old ABI Sanger instruments versus smartphones that now anybody can run in a lab. These nanopore instruments are basically free. They give them to you, and you just pay for the reagents. Jim Breyer is in the audience from ONT if you'd like to buy some nanopore instruments. That's not an endorsement. I want to talk about the democratization of sequencing, that if we have that same phenomenon where we go from everybody has a computer in their pocket now to everybody has a sequencer in their pocket, this worries me a little bit. Back in the day, we had trained teams that knew how to analyze this data, and there was some measure of quality control involved. Now it's the Wild West that everybody's running nanopores all over the place. They don't have the same training and expertise. That's not to say this is a bad thing. It's just a dangerous thing that we need to be careful about how this is done, that we do it correctly, and that the informaticians develop the right tools for this job. So sequencing, these are just some observations. Sequencing is rapidly becoming free, where you don't have to pay for it. Anybody can do it. That doesn't mean the analysis is free. So how do we democratize the analysis of the data? You can sequence to your heart's delight. If it comes off, are you going to know what to do with that data? Do you have the tools required to analyze it properly? When this is ubiquitous, we risk the problem of silos. We already have this problem now, where the amount of data that's actually in GenBank is probably a fraction of a percent of the data that's actually been generated to date. And that's all just kind of wasted data to me if it just sits in somebody's lab computer and they're not sharing it with anybody. Okay, they're probably good at the one line of research that they want to study, but there's a lot of wasted data. how can we incentivize data sharing now that everybody can sequence? And lastly, I'm thinking now about a sensor-based network where everybody's sequencing. There's a sequencer in every lab that has analogies to sensor-based networks, which I'll talk about. What can we do with all of that data? There's still a lot left to sequence. We haven't sequenced everything, all right? If we take all the humans in the USA, 10 to the 8, they've got a lot of bacteria within them. Don't nitpick that number. I just pulled that off the web. I'm sure you can argue about how many bacteria are in a human all day. Let's estimate there's 1 million bases per bacterium. 10 to the minus 10 meters per nucleic acid. That's 10 light years of microbiome in the United States that you can sequence. So there will be plenty of DNA for you to sequence in the coming years, and all of that needs to be analyzed. So that's enough DNA to go to the nearest star and back again. So how do we deal with that? So 8 years ago, when the Nanopore instruments were first being released, I started thinking, well, this seems like a weather network, all right? Where you think back in the day, there was this weather bug network where they would basically give away these cheap sensors, the schools would put them up in their backyard, and all of that data would get collected, and then you can make beautiful patterns like this plot of wind speed and direction in the United States at any particular point in time. If you go to this hint.fm website, it's a real-time, cool, animated picture of what the wind in the USA looks like right now, okay? So imagine if that wasn't wind, imagine if that was DNA being sequenced at hospitals, doctor's offices, classrooms, backyards, who knows where. What do we do with it? If all of that data is siloed, where we're not sharing it like we are here, all of this data is sourced from NOAA, so National Oceanographic Administration, Atmosphere Administration in the US. They collect all of this data from across the US, put it in one spot so you can analyze it. If we're all sequencing in our labs and not sharing it, we might be able to see what's going on in Dallas, but not Columbus, and this can have bad consequences, because if this was the wind map of the United States, we have trouble. If you're only looking in your neighborhood, you don't see the larger patterns, right? So if we're thinking about infectious disease outbreak, infectious disease spread, if you're only looking in your neighborhood and you're not looking at the country across the way or the state or the city across the way or the hospital across the street, you're gonna miss these patterns. And so finding transmissions of infectious disease and so on, I think will be greatly enabled by large-scale collection of this type of data. So original vision was something like this, all of these MinIONs connected, sourced through something like NCBI and analyzed. And NCBI, and particularly the Food and Drug Administration, to their credit, have been leaders in this over the past 10 years. And early on, they partnered, FDA that is, partnered with NCBI to get all the foodborne isolates that were being sequenced and isolated at the FDA labs across the US, sequenced on Illumina and shoved into NCBI for analysis. And now they have this thing called, I think it's called pathogen tracker, where you go, genome tracker, you go and there's a special page in NCBI you can analyze. It has every Salmonella genome you could ever want, because basically FDA is sequencing every Salmonella genome that they find. And there's been a number of really cool stories where somebody in Australia is looking at the updates that come into that NCBI website and said, hey, that's the same isolate that we just saw last week. And that's how they figure out now where the transmission events for foodborne outbreaks are happening. So we're there, the time is ripe. If you're in informatics and genomics, be excited. I think there's great things to come. And with that, I'll save some time for questions.